Welcome to the last breakout session. At this session, we are going to talk about water and the impacts of climate change on water. We've had some really great information, and I'm sure each of us has picked up on some interesting tidbits throughout the afternoon. I actually sort of honed in on Mace's comment when, if any of you were in the session, the 2 o'clock session, when he mentioned that water is the connecting point between urban and rural centers. And I thought, yeah, that water is the connecting point for so many things. And I am with the Groundwater Foundation. My name is Jane Griffin. And so, as most of you know, when we talk about water in Nebraska, we really are talking about groundwater, as it serves so much of our population. It provides the food that we eat, and a lot of our recreational enjoyment also is because of our groundwater supplies. One thing that we like to say at the Groundwater Foundation is that groundwater is the environmental bottom line. So whatever is happening above the Earth's surface often shows up in our groundwater. And the question I think that we have today that we're going to try and dive into is, how is climate change going to show up in our groundwater? And how are we going to be able to manage that so that the groundwater that we rely on today is still here tomorrow and for future generations? Good news for you guys is I'm not going to talk to you the whole time, because another thing about the Groundwater Foundation is that we rely on the experts to bring their perspective into the topics that we try and address and bring to each of you. So today we have a few different experts from different sectors, and we're going to go through and have some questions for each of those. Ideally, these questions are going to generate a bit of a discussion amongst our panelists, and then at the end we will have some time for some question and answers from the audience as well. So I'm going to start off by introducing our four panel members. Okay, so raise your hand when I mention your name, because they have we did not seat them in any specific order. So Bob Swanson. Bob is the director of the USGS Nebraska Water Science Center. And at the Science Center, they have 45 dedicated water science professionals, support personnel, and students. The center has offices in Lincoln and North Platte, and Bob himself oversees a science program that is managed through two sections, hydrologic surveillance and hydrologic investigations. Bob and his team really do collect a lot of really pertinent information that helps so many people make the correct decisions. In fact, USGS operates over 120 stream gauging stations, 70 continuous groundwater recorders, and compiles groundwater levels for over 5,000 wells just in the state of Nebraska. Karen Griffin is a professional geologist who, by the way, learned everything from me. I am her sister, so. She actually is a professional geologist managing multidisciplinary projects focused in the fields of geology and hydrogeology. Karen began her career in environmental geology in Santa Barbara, California, then moved to Boulder to take a position as a project manager for the restoration and cleanup of a Superfund site called the Rocky Mountain Arsenal National Wildlife Refuge. Karen moved back to Lincoln, our hometown, in 2004, and she's currently vice president and the groundwater technical leader at Olson Associates in Lincoln, Nebraska. Next, we have Mike Sousek. Sousek, how did I write that wrong, Mike? Thank you. Anyway, Mike is a native of Nebraska and received many life lessons growing up on a dryland farm near Wahoo, Nebraska. Mike has more than 15 years of experience working within the NRD field and has focused primarily on water quality and quantity issues. Mike currently is the general manager for the Lower Elkhorn Natural Resources District. And last but not least is Kim Morrow. Kim is passionate about finding smart, compassionate, and community-based solutions to the environmental challenges of our time. Kim, originally an ordained minister, has a passion for healthy ecosystems, and this led her to combine social justice with climate change and sustainability work in a variety of settings in Nebraska. Kim brings a holistic perspective to helping her clients at the Verdis Group attend to the triple bottom line of people, profits, and planet, and the planet. So Kim, as well as all of our other panelists, has had a wide range of experiences that really bring collectively a great amount of knowledge to our panelists today. One thing I do have to mention, though, is that Kim recently did have a very special award given to her. She was honored at the White House as the Champion of Change. Because Kim is the Champion of Change, I thought it would be appropriate to start with her with our first question. So let me get back to my cheat sheet. Ever that went, there it is. Okay. So as I said, we're going to have a few questions that our panelists each are going to answer, and then we'll open it up at the end for some discussion from you. So very briefly, and this can be from one word to about 200 words, I'd like each of you, and starting, like I said, with Kim, to help us understand what you consider to be the biggest threat posed by climate change to our water supply.
Okay, well, it's five phrases, not five words, five phrases. High temperature stress days, droughts, decreasing soil moisture, and decreasing snowpack in the Rocky Mountains. And you've all heard the explanations of all these factors this morning, so I'm just reiterating what's already been said. But all of those five factors combined conspire to put a very great strain on our water resources in Nebraska.
Very good. Kim, why don't you pass it on to Mike, and we'll...
Same question. I'm going to be on repeat mode here too. The variability of the frequency of the storms, but also the intensity of the storms, going from a lack of no rain and then a couple months later having flooding events. So both of those things lead to the sustainability of the resource, the water resource itself. So I see things playing out at the local level, and it's definitely very concerning.
So this is Karen Griffin, the other Griffin here. Variability is my word for what we have as the biggest threat to our water supplies. And as Mike mentioned, the floods and the droughts, we had the 2010 flood in the Elkhorn in his natural resource district. We had the 2012 droughts. And so as a scientist and engineer at a consulting firm, we have to plan and engineer for that. And that has changed our work dramatically. We're doing a lot more planning for the future and how to react to the changes in the climate, but also our engineers. I asked a couple days ago, anticipating this question, our senior hydrologic engineer in our office does a whole lot of work for railroads in this country, UP and BNSF, and he has said that he has had to change how he does his engineering designs. He used to look at the past and design for the 100-year floods from the past. What was the 100-year flood a year ago, or in the past? You can't use those as your design criteria anymore. You have to look at the most recent floods and then plan for that in worse. So that's how I see the issues of variability is our biggest threat to the water supply.
Well, that's an excellent segue, because the science guy is probably not going to answer with a science question, but we do live in an age now of non-stationarity. 15 years ago, we thought if we studied a hydrologic system for 30 years, we'd understand it. But it's all that it stayed the same over time. And now we know that it's a sliding scale. And it's moving and changing all the time. And so we can't just study it for 30 years. We have to keep studying it. And climate change is like throwing that frog in a pot of water and waiting for it to boil. our biggest threat, as I see it, is not recognizing when the frog is going to die. And I know that people like Karen are playing a big part in this with the integrated management plans across Nebraska, and that is planning for the point 50 to 100 years down the road or more when the frog dies and the pot's boiling. When we get together as groups and we throw ourselves into the planning exercise, it's typically, what do we need now? Or what do we need 10 years down the line? We forget to look down the line far enough to our grandchildren and their grandchildren that what we do now is going to affect them. And typically those plans focus on agriculture in Nebraska, because by far agriculture and irrigation is the largest water user. But as those, as climate change, if you're a believer in the warming planet, and I am, that's going to impinge upon those supplies. And that's going to mean that we're going to have to share it with municipalities and industry. And so there's going to be a lot more competition for the same amount of water that we manage pretty well today through the NRD system. We've already seen the impact that, and Mike in particular, the impact of the last drought, and a pretty short drought in terms of the Great Plains, where typically 30 to 100 years of drought is not all that uncommon in our past history. Who knows what's coming up in the future, but I think we can expect at least those kind of variations in the future. So
that's great. That's Bob, that's perfect actually for leading into my next question. And I'd really like Karen and Mike to focus on this, because Karen and Mike both are, you know, everybody's on the ground in their way, but specifically I think for this next question, you guys can give some insight. So the question is, in your work, have you already experienced events or episodes that impact Nebraska's water resources that can be attributed to climate change? And if so, please share. If not, what do you think is around the corner that we need to be ready for?
Simple answer is yes. We've already mentioned the 2010 flood, followed by the 2012 drought. Going back to what Bob was just saying, the competition for water, it gets very stressful when 600 people show up at your office screaming at you that they have nothing to drink or take a bath in, and the farmers are screaming at you that they can't raise their corn. So we've seen the effects of the drought. We've seen the effects of the flooding. We part of our responsibility is for flood control, and as Karen was mentioned, we design dams for the 100-year flood or the 500-year storm event. You're seeing those every other storms, 100-year storm, and you're starting to hear the 1,000-year storm. I mean, what's next to build an ark? it's just getting ridiculous, really. So the district's taking the approach to start planning. Start planning at the 10,000-foot level. We're in a basin coalition with six other NRDs. We're doing a water budget, trying to figure out, is there a surplus? Is there not enough water? We're meeting together and setting bookmarks on how we can develop the groundwater at a rate that's manageable. And so then at a more local level, we're doing the integrated management plan that Bob mentioned. Karen's been a huge part of that, helping the district do that. And there we're working with the state to make sure we have enough water left in the creeks and the streams and the river, and so that we don't overdevelop. And then at the even localer level, we're going through a process for a drought mitigation plan. How do we address the next 2012? 4 years ago, the district took the stance that everything got shut down. We completely put a halt on everything, and we're still trying to unwind from that decision. So getting into the weeds. We're requiring meters on everything, every high capacity well. That's going to be our management tool. That when the next time comes, we're going to share and share alike, and everyone's going to be maybe on an allocation. Here's your allocation, and do the best you can with it. But we have to take in consideration municipalities, domestic use, agriculture, livestock, and there's a lot of competing interest out there. And to balance that, and when they all show up yelling, is gets a little stressful. So hopefully we're getting the plans in place that when it happens the next time, we have some direction. And of course, they're all living documents. We can modify them. We can adjust them as we go. But we'll have the framework in place to hopefully manage the groundwater.
All right. I think I want to describe a little bit more about what these integrated management plans are, just in case some of you haven't heard about those. In the state of Nebraska, the legislation in the early 2000s recognized the connection between groundwater and surface water. And I have to admit, that's when I decided to move back to Nebraska. It had to be clear, or else I wasn't about to move back to do my job. We know that they are integrated and they work together. So at that same time, the state was also realizing they needed to work and make these plans, these integrated management plans, groundwater and surface water, together. They started in the West, and that was related to Platte River recovery for endangered species, also compact compliance in the Republican River. What's happened here on the eastern side of the state is the eastern natural resource districts have taken it upon themselves to do integrated management plans, so they work towards sustainable water use before they get to the point where they have depleted too far down and have to cut back on uses. They've voluntarily put down some moratoriums and have changed some of their practices. But this is a really amazing step forward, and it takes a state like Nebraska to come up with natural resource districts where you have a local government agency that is managing the groundwater for your own interests. So obviously, I think these integrated management plans are doing a great job for our state. They're looking forward to that sustainable water use. They also take into account not only one water user, they look at municipalities, they look at agriculture, recreation use, and conservation. So when we put together these integrated management plans, all of those stakeholders are brought to the table, and they come up with plans like Mike was talking about, putting water meters on their wells, using cost share programs to encourage conservation practices like conversion from flood irrigation to sprinkler systems, and other things like that. And then the last thing that the legislature has done that's really been fantastic for these integrated management planning process is they've come up with funding to implement those projects that come out of the planning. Just a couple of years ago, the Water Sustainability Fund was developed and approved through the state. The Water Sustainability Fund is a fund that it started out with $31 million, and then will have an annual allocation of $11 million. Natural resource districts, water users in the state can apply for funding to build the projects that will help with sustainable water use in this state. So you'll be hearing more and more about that as these projects get to move forward. But if the natural resource district identifies the need for a dam for flood control or for other projects to like meters so they can actually identify how much water is being used, those are the kinds of projects this fund will help with.
Great. That actually is a perfect segue then into my next question. There's been two words that have come out in these answers by Mike and Karen. The first one being funding. I being the head of a nonprofit, I know what that all is about and how difficult it is to find the funding. But I think all of us in this room will agree that we can't afford not to find the funding to address the problems that we have to address. And I know Bob from USGS can also identify with the issue of funding, because so much of the work that USGS does, the research, et cetera, really is driven by the funding that they have available. So with that, I would like to pose the next question to Bob and find out, and if Bob, you can share with the audience, what research is USGS doing regarding climate change and its impact on our water resources, and how does USGS expect that research to help people like Mike, Kim, and Karen, and the rest of us in this room to address climate change?
Okay. Well, probably the most prominent in the U.S. geological. Okay, right up here.
Yep.
I like to think I'm pretty loud, but that's much better. Probably the most prominent U.S. geological survey program is the climate change program right now, just because of the information that's coming out of it. Now, we have 8 regional climate science centers, and the University of Nebraska is one of the co-sponsors of a consortium that works with the North Central Climate Science Center. But these are largely funded for wildlife research, not for global climate change in a particular way. But some of the other programs that we have, like the National Research Program, and does things that you hear about every day, but you may not know that we do it. The biggest of which is the Landsat system, which almost all of the climate modelers and all of the consultants across the country that are doing any kind of modeling with climate and precipitation and land use. The Landsat program is kind of the poster child for the country, and often NASA gets the nod for that program. They put it into orbit. It's our satellite. And it's run out of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, so it's just right up the roads where all that information comes out of. There's also the Arctic sea ice surveys. Every year, the USGS participates in the survey that delineates how much permanent ice there is in the Arctic ice cap, and they do the same type of work down in Antarctica. So there's all kinds of information. When we all have friends, we all know people who deny climate change is an issue, but I see all of these different lines of evidence that continue to come together that, okay, you're going to discount one, are you going to discount the other 20 or 30? There's the National Phenology Network, and I said phenology. I don't mean bumps on your head. Phenology is the study of the timing of events. So there is a national program which you can participate in if you go and Google it. They're always looking for citizen scientists to participate in it. It's the timing of things like when does a particular tree bud out at your location. When do you see the first monarch butterfly of the year? There's all kinds of information that you can put into that helps us know just when these events are changing and how much they're changing geographically. Probably my biggest love and the biggest passion is the one that Jane mentioned, and that's hydrologic surveillance. I used to be chief of the hydrologic surveillance program in Wyoming, and I always loved it because it sounded like water spies. But it's the ongoing program, for me, that particular part of our program is like the BASF commercial. You know, they're not the guys that do the climate study. They're the guys that collect the information that the people that do the climate studies do. That's stream gauges collected over 100 years in this country. And that's pretty long, but you can go back in Egypt, and the Nile has records going back a couple thousand years. We don't have that here. But the ongoing stream flows, the water levels that we collect or that we compile from folks like Mike's NRDs provide us with a lot of information that we can then use over time to decide what's happening with our groundwater levels. Those type of things happen every day, every year, year after year after year, and they don't get any praise for what they're doing. But we wouldn't know about climate change or global warming if it hadn't have been for the solitary person sitting out at some weather station in Bangkok collecting water temperature, air temperature every day a couple hundred years ago. Or the person sitting on Mauna Loa, which probably wouldn't have been
as bad
collecting CO2 information. The USGS also has the investigations that we operate out of our office in Lincoln. And the biggest program that we're proud of is the groundwater modeling expertise that we have. We just finished up a model of the Northern High Plains aquifer. You'd know it as the Ogallala, but the High Plains aquifer system is really a collection of several different aquifers. And that's 100,000 square miles on quarter-mile grids. To run a model like that and get it to calibrate well is very difficult. Depends on accurate information being collected, like I talked about before, and it depends on people to write good code for that model. We're using that model now with the USDA Economic Research Service to be able to help predict the consequences of climate change to the economics of people within this region. And we've also conducted the brackish groundwater study. So as climate change impacts our state and the nation, as water becomes a more crucial resource, we may have to look at using water like the Dakota aquifer that's pretty nasty to drink in some places. In other places, it's pretty good. But we may have to look at using those types of water that we would never have considered using before, finding acceptable uses for them or ways to treat them that they would be.
Very good. Thank you. That's great information, Bob. That's the type of information, and also the information that Kim has had a part in compiling. I know we've talked about the study, the UNL study on the impacts of climate change. Karen can be my Vanna White and show that. Kim was a part of that study, and Kim now works at the Verdis Group. And the question, Kim, that I'd like to pose to you is, you know, what was the most outstanding lesson that you learned with your research conducted at UNL that you are now able to apply and utilize with your clients at the Verdis Group?
Great. Well, last year I had the fortune of being able to work with Dr. Don Wilhite, a professor of applied climatology at UNL, and we worked on the second runner-up to that report, which was a report on the convening of 9 sector-based roundtables that we did over the course of the year. And this was in order to lay the groundwork, potentially, hopefully, for a Nebraska State Climate Action Plan. And so we brought together 9 roundtables on the topics of ecosystems, human health, forestry and fire, ag, food and water, energy availability, faith communities, college campuses, urban and rural communities, and youth. And these were fascinating and important conversations, all of them. And so I think the biggest lesson that I took with me from that work was really the need and the opportunity for these sectors to work together, to continue to work together. It's kind of like what you said, Mike, when you've got all these different people coming at you with different needs and different potential conflicts, you can extrapolate that to a statewide level. All of these sectors are seeing stresses. They have different pain points, different needs. And when we can bring them together in a room and have conversation when we're not in the midst of a crisis, and hopefully they're not screaming at each other, we can proactively mitigate those risks. The kind of integrated resource planning that you're doing, Karen, is exactly also the same kind of work we can take to a statewide level to create a state climate action plan. So I'm hoping that work will continue at the state legislature and at the university. I will also say the biggest challenge I found in the work that I did was understanding the inertia that exists on moving forward in creating a climate plan in our state. There's political inertia and there's institutional inertia. There's fear. You know, I think we in Nebraska are so nice. We've got the Nebraska nice thing going on where we don't want to offend anyone. And that also translates into politicians not wanting to offend voters. It translates into organizations not wanting to offend their donors. It translates into leaders not wanting to offend our congressional delegation for fear of losing their funding. So it's really pervasive, and it's disheartening. And so I hope that in the coming years, granted we have even more challenging political environment than we had before with the recent election. And I don't know if all of you have checked the news on your mobile phones while you've been here, but President-elect Trump has appointed a person to lead the EPA today. I think his name is Scott Pruitt. Is that right? He's a friend of the fossil fuel industry who has promised to roll back a lot of the progress that we have been able to make so far on climate change. So we've got a very challenging environment that we're working in, and I think that calls us all to be even more bold than we were before in a nonpartisan way to move forward to protect our people and our resources here in Nebraska.
Yeah, that's I think you guys are almost like on cue for providing the segue for me perfectly. Actually, my last question is specifically, and I'd like each of you just to take a couple of minutes to answer, given the outcome of the recent elections and the new appointee to the head of EPA, what do each of you expect to be the obstacles moving forward, whether that be in your research or in your proactive actions to prevent, you know, to reduce the impacts of climate change? So as you're talking about the obstacles, if you can also possibly mention what you think each of us, you know, as we've talked about, it's the collaborative effort that we need. What can each of us sitting in this room do? Mike, you're first on board, it looks like.
Well, I'm a big proponent of local control. I truly believe the people living in the area know best for what to do in that area. So some of these things that might be getting rolled back with EPA, I'm looking forward to it. The regulations with the Corps of Engineers and with the Waters of the United States was not going to help the situation in my local district. We're doing studies. We're flying electromagnetic imaging over aquifers. We're mapping these. We're making an atlas of all the aquifers in our district. We're taking that and we're doing groundwater modeling. We know what needs to be done. We're encouraging cover crops to start capturing some of these things and not only improve water quality, but water quantity, the amount of water that's going to be in the soil. Some of these things, if the feds were in charge, may have not helped our situation. It was going to be a undue burden, an expense for our local taxpayers that wasn't going to help anything. So I'm a big proponent of local control. I'm trying to educate my board every meeting we have on the issues, so they're prepared to make the decisions that need to be made for our district. And so I continue to try to go for grant funds to do more studies, to get as much information as we can, and then put it in those guys' lap and say, here, how do we fix this for us rather than have the federal government tell us how to fix it?
Perfect.
I think that, I think there's an opportunity to make progress in lots of the other sectors besides legislative. Given what I just said, I hope we continue to move forward on the legislative efforts. But I also think there's an opportunity to move forward in the private sector now. The business community has already made some strong statements recently that have been very helpful. And some of the work that I do now at Verdis Group, we do sustainability consulting for typically large organizations to help them become more sustainable. And the advantage of working in that sector is you don't need any any legislation, it doesn't matter who's president, you can move forward in huge and dramatic ways on a local level to make progress. And I just wanted to throw out one statistic. One of our clients is the University of Nebraska Medical Center, and over the past 5 years, they have been able to lower their energy usage by 25%, and they've saved $15 million in the process of doing that. So that's just an example of how a private, public organization can make a substantial difference in our local community. Apart from that, I would recommend, if you haven't done it already, everyone should take their carbon footprint. It gives you, you can go to carbonfootprint.org, and it gives you a really detailed analysis of your own environmental impact and give you ideas for how you can reduce that. Just one idea.
I will. I'm thinking, Karen. I've got to think. I see Kevin back there, and we work for an organization that's been flat funded for about 15 years. So, yet we're asked to do more each year with more with less is getting to be a pretty hard thing to do. But I'm also a big fan of these new technologies that are coming along. That, you know, water levels is the pulse of groundwater and water within Nebraska, and the continuous recorders are the EKG. But the airborne electromagnetic surveys that Mike mentioned, that's the MRI. I mean, that's what shows you the whole, gives you the whole body of the beast, and really allows you to look in and see really what you're dealing with. It's invisible, it's under the ground, and we've made all of these guesses about what's underneath our feet, and probably 95% of it's wrong, right, Mike? So, those types of things, if we have that kind of information, it makes my groundwater models mine, all of the groundwater models that are produced within the state, so much better. So there's a lot of good coming down the road that we're going to be able to manage this resource better, and it doesn't really the challenges will still be there. We'll be able to do it.
Very good.
I think I'll just finish up with a personal passion of mine, and that is that since you guys have brought up some really good ideas already, I think we need to continue to educate our youth and everyone about this issue. I get a lot of questions as a geologist. There was one earlier today. Well, this used to be, an ocean in Nebraska, and the climates have changed through history and through time in this earth. We need to help educate people so they can answer those questions and explain what these changes in the climate are happening now are related to our impacts. The reason I'm saying that education is so important, too, is to answer and help answer these questions that we're faced. We're going to need more scientists and more engineers. And so please continue to support your schools, continue to encourage students to go into these sciences and engineering. There'll be more dams and floods to deal with. There'll be more measurements to take. So we just need to continue with that.
That's great. I said I was going to ask the panelists, but anybody who knows me knows that I do like to express my opinion, so I'm going to answer my own question as well with sort of my portion of this wrap-up and then opening it up to all of you. So the point I'd like to make is that events like today are fabulous for the learning. You know, as Karen mentioned, it is really important that all of us continue to learn. To understand what climate change, what it means to us. But at events like this, it also can be overwhelming and think, oh my gosh, how this is such a huge issue. What can I possibly do, me, this one person, to face this and to make a difference on this? And we do need to remember, as so many of our presenters pointed out, that so much of what is happening in our climate is due to our human actions and our choices. And as our population explodes, so does the demand on products and goods that each of us that are needed. And in fact, not only have they estimated what the population's going to be in a few decades, there's also estimates as how much manufacturing is going to have to increase. And that's estimated around 400%. That's where I say we come in, because manufacturers respond to our demands. So if we're demanding the larger homes, if we're demanding more cars, if we're demanding whatever it may be, even the pair of jeans, and FYI, takes about 3,000 gallons of water to produce a pair of jeans. So how many jeans do we really need? Anyway, it's those types of decisions and choices that we can make that the manufacturers will respond to. Less demand, less production. So that's where we come into the play, the solution. We all are a part of the solution with the informed decisions that we can make when we're choosing the things that we want and need. So with that, I would like to open it up. We have a few minutes left. Everyone was wonderfully on time for some questions. And I see a woman right there.
Where do you want to look at the aquifer? It's probably the most frequent press request that we get out of anything we do out of our office. We've had, and we get inquiries from Japanese television, from National Geographic, from Time Magazine. Jenny McGuire out of my office, I think, has probably got the most repeated graphic in at any of the groundwater conferences in the country is the groundwater level change of the Ogallala Aquifer, and is the aquifer going to be pumped dry? In some it will never be pumped dry in any of parts of it. I mean, an aquifer is like a sponge, and pumping, you can think of it as squeezing out of it, but it will eventually yield all, it'll pump all the water that it will yield. There'll still be water in the aquifer. And we have the benefit of having over 1,000 feet of unconsolidated aquifer here within our state. Does that mean that, and I've been in meetings where folks have said, we've got all the water we need, we can keep drilling, we can keep pumping, but you only have to draw that aquifer down a few feet before the streams start to feel it, the groundwater-fed streams. Lincoln and Omaha get most of their water from the Platte River, but they don't get it from the Rockies. They get it from the sand hills. So depleting that aquifer a few feet has a big impact on the streams that get down here to provide water for this part of the state. The Great Lakes gets about $300 million a year from EPA alone for scientific investigations and studies and monitoring of the Great Lakes. They've got a lot of people around the Great Lakes. Nobody lives on the Great Lakes. Well, there might be a few houseboats, but we have the equivalent of one of the Great Lakes underneath our feet. We live on it, and we don't get a fraction of that type of funding to study what's going on with it. But and here within Nebraska, we're very fortunate to have the NRD system that, as Mike mentions, manages it locally. And it's managed, for the most part, by agricultural folks who know that if they run out of water, they're out of business. So I think we probably have one of the most proactive systems in the country of folks that have to be responsible for what they're doing and realize that without it, their children are out of a livelihood. Did that answer your question? Or
did anybody else want to add anything to that? Karen?
A geologist perspective to that, too. If you look at the High Plains Aquifer from Nebraska and then it goes down into Kansas and Texas, the geology changes dramatically. We have the sand hills, so the recharge is much greater. As you move south to Kansas, it's clays and silts. in Texas as hard pans. So the recharge just doesn't happen, and they are in much more dire straits, clearly.
Yep, and you reminded me that in Texas, the landowner owns the water. And so they have every incentive to pump it till it's gone. In Nebraska, you all own it. And so we all have a piece of that decision. If we don't like what people are doing with it, we can we have a voice about it. And there's a much different, it is the poster child of different water management practices. Mm-hmm. So at the same time, I've also told people that, if Nebraska was 700 miles further south and we had the ability to grow two crops during a season, we'd probably have been pumping a lot more water in the 50s and 60s. Mm-hmm. So some of our pride in what we're doing is earned, and some of it is by accident of location.
Great. Yes. Mm-hmm. How do you monitor? Oh.
She asked, Omaha and Lincoln are using a lot of water out of the Saunders County aquifer, which goes into Douglas and Sarpy. But anyway, how do we monitor whether that water is being put to good use, a beneficial use? And I think golf courses are a good use of the groundwater. It all becomes on your perspective of where you're at. And it goes back to share and share alike. Follow state law, it goes domestic, ag, industry. So domestic use is going to have the top priority. But towns, I know the city of Lincoln has a very comprehensive water plan. When there's a drought, things go into effect, and people have to share alike. And so to cut out the industry in the ag in the municipal sector, they're using a drop in the whole bucket. 94% of the water in the state's being used for irrigation on corn or beans. 5% is to municipalities and 2% is for industry. So we could get rid of all the industry and still have the problem if during a time of shortage. They're not using that much water.
And both the state of Nebraska and USGS collect information on water use from municipalities and industries, from the power utilities, from the irrigation districts, and we get a lot of that information from the natural resource districts, but we collect that and have for many decades now, going back to at least 1985, and there were some for a national water use program. Before that, there were other water use programs, but we do keep track of what's happening with water use on a county by county basis. So,
yep, and I think that's you bring up a good point with the issue of beneficial use, because that is always very in each person's perspective, what is beneficial and what isn't. That's a hard thing to determine. One thing I would like to point out, you'll notice the blue folders on your chairs. I handed those out. Please make sure you take one. And it does talk about some of the programs that we have at the Groundwater Foundation. One of them is the Green Site Program. And the Green Sites Program was actually originally created for golf courses, because not all of them are bad actors. There are lots out there that are recycling water, that are doing very innovative things. And that program actually was created so the ones that are doing the good things that may be seen in the bad actors sector actually have the opportunity to get recognized for the good things that they're doing. Also in that folder is a couple other things about the programs. Karen mentioned Educate. There's a lot of great education things that we offer, and we actually have an activities library funded thanks to the Environmental Trust. We were able to create an activities library where you can go and search, I want an outdoor activity for kids ages 6 to 10 or whatever it is, and you get a whole slew of different activities and all of the instructions of how to do that. So as Karen said, educate, educate, educate. I think we've got time for one more question. Who's the lucky person that's... Yes.
I'm going to turn that over to the geologist. I've got an answer for it, but.
I'm just going to say, in my first career move, out of grad school, I was working in Santa Barbara where there was an 8-year drought when I was living there. And my boss was the water commissioner, and he actually had to drill a well in the reservoir because the reservoir went dry. That on the front page of the paper made a big impact, and people started to conserve a lot more. But yes, it is subsidence due to aquifer removal of the water from the aquifer is an issue. I don't think that's geologically an issue here in Nebraska. I've not heard of it.
No, because it's a question that I've asked of the people that are experiencing the same thing, and it's the type of geology that underlies that region. Now that we may, there are places that have experienced some minor subsidence in Nebraska, but nothing like the 35 to 50 feet in other parts of the country. And it has been an issue in other parts of the Ogallala, in the southern parts, but not with us. But you know, if you go down to Texas, where we have natural resource districts, they have subsidence districts.
Okay, one more question. Yes. I'm going to throw a question out to the audience. Do you know how many miles of pipelines are through our aquifer?
That's about 9,000 in Nebraska. So when you ask that question, it's like, okay, what do you do about the other 8,500 miles, and you know, how did you get here? I'm more concerned that they're built correctly, and that there's monitoring around them, which we've done a little bit of monitoring around the original Keystone, but we're not anymore. That they pay particular attention to river crossings and places where those breaks can rapidly escalate in the potential for damage and remediation. One of my people worked on the Kalamazoo pipeline for almost 5 years, remediation, being there on site for a cleanup for something that happened over the course of 10 hours. You know, if it breaks on the surface at a particular location, then maybe a square mile is affected. If it gets into the water the waterway, then hundreds of miles may be affected. We know from the Bemidji oil spill that USGS has been monitoring for close to 40 years now. So we've monitored the effects of the plume and how far it goes, but that all depends in each individual geographic setting and geological setting.
And I have to come back to understanding the system that you're putting it in and making sure that you've designed it right and that you've sited the pipeline in the right location. I mean, sensitive habitats, waterways, all that need to be taken into account.
I'm more concerned about the water quality issues I currently have and getting those messes cleaned up, and I haven't spent much time worried about a pipeline that isn't running through my district, so.
Yeah, and one, you know, one thing I'd like to point out, because there has been a lot of discussion about that, and you know, at the Groundwater Foundation, we say any drop of water that's polluted is a loss of, you know, and we don't want to see that. But the one thing that I also like to remind people of is, what is our number one problem here of contaminant? And that's nitrate. And that's something that we really, really, really need to focus on, and each of us needs to be doing our part towards that. So let's look at the full picture. And what are the threats that we have? And Chelsea told me I only had one question, but if it's real, real quick and we have brief answers, we'll break the rule. Right. 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 I think my panelists were responding more to the threat of contamination, if I'm speaking correctly, about, you know, the pipeline. All of the other issues are absolutely at the forefront and need to be completely considered. So I agree with that.
Please don't leave here thinking that that we said that pipelines were a good thing. Ask me about neonicotinoids. You know, this is neonics or something that's added to almost every seed treatment in this part of the country. So it covers almost 100% of the land surface, and there's serious implications about that.
Yeah, and I think we do have the cocktail hour, so it sounds like it's going to be very animated if we keep the discussion up there. So let's thank all of our panelists for their information. It is.